Confessions About Colton, a Hachette audio original, powered by Wattpad. Written by Olivia Harvard. Read by Ricco Fajardo. Prologue. I remember when Colton Chris disappeared. I mean, of course I did. He was my best friend. His disappearance stirred up a hell of a lot of commotion across Woodsworth, our small, rural town. Hampton High was the worst, like you'd expect any high school to be. Students started rumors, teachers gave out false information, parents gossiped. Some said he went to jail. Others announced he was abducted. No one knew where he had gone. Not even me. Not even Colton's family had a clue about their son's whereabouts. Whenever they addressed the issue, they dismissed it and repeated the same monotone explanation. He was visiting relatives. But you could see the distress in Mrs. Crest's eyes, the haunting shadows that appeared as her motherly instincts told herself to prepare for the worst. A month after Colton's disappearance, it was still the same. Stories spread like wildfire, residents greedily feeding off false tales like leeches. This continued for yet another month, but by this time, the Crests seemed a lot calmer. They had obtained some information, but they seemed unwilling to share. This didn't particularly bother me at the time. I trusted that he'd take care of himself. If his folks were calm enough, then I should be too. The days continued to pass. Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. It was a Saturday when I heard the unexpected knock on my door. July 26th, the day Colton Crest came back to town. Hey, have you got a beer? I stared at him as he shrugged off his jacket and went into the kitchen, raiding my fridge like he always did. The fact that he just turned up at my place like he hadn't been missing for 2 months was unbelievable. But there he was. He hadn't shaved in a while, and he was missing his usual smile, but he seemed to be physically unharmed. He pulled out a six-pack and pushed past me to bring the drinks out onto the pergola. I followed, my eyes glued to him as I picked up a beer. Colton remained calm, pulling out his pocket watch every now and then to study the time with unnerving fascination. The watch was a classic piece of him, and there was never a moment he didn't have it hooked onto the back loop of his jeans. The family heirloom was priceless, both in financial and sentimental value. I watched as he placed it back in his pocket before I took a swig of liquid courage, letting it quench my dry throat and ignite a fire in my stomach. Then I got down to business. "Where have you been, man?" I asked him. "And quit the bull about being with family." He smiled and tipped his bottle of beer to his lips. "Stop trying to play detective, Elliot. Some mysteries just can't be solved." I never asked him again after that. I guess I didn't want to push him to a point where he'd disappear again, so I kept quiet. But no one else did. Questions were asked, gossip was spread, and the story of Colton's disappearance had him at the height of his high school fame. This continued for the next 4 months, all the way to the night before graduation. I took Milo for a walk that evening. He was starting to resemble a walking cheese puff, so some exercise was well overdue. We took our old route at the back of the house, keeping close to the park behind my neighborhood, then went out onto the street, where we took a shortcut towards the local lake. The sun was just over the horizon, the sky performing its grand finale of color transitions. The streets were empty. The spring air was fresh. Other than my dog's excessive panting as he worked his stubby legs, everything was tranquil. But as soon as we reached the edge of the water, Milo went absolutely mental. The fur on the back of his neck stood high and alert as he barked hysterically at something by the dock. At first, I thought there was another dog, or a bird he wanted to chase. But when he started pulling me towards the water, I realized what had gotten him so on edge. There was a body floating in the lake. "Shit," I whispered to myself as my fingers searched my pockets for my phone. But something made me hesitate. The sinking sun's light fell upon the back pocket of the deceased's jeans and reflected off a shiny surface. It was blinding for a split second, causing me to look away. A sinking feeling settled in my stomach, and my insides began to churn. I knew one object with a surface as polished as that. My hands started shaking, and Milo's barks were replaced by silence. I suddenly felt lightheaded. I forced myself to look up, to ensure my imagination wasn't getting the better of me. But when I saw the pocket watch, I knew it was him. Colton Crest was dead. 1. There are 5 main stages of grief. 1. Denial. 2. Anger. 3. Bargaining. 4. Depression. 5. Acceptance. When the police and an ambulance arrived, stage 1 commenced. I watched the evidence unfold before me. A couple of policemen went out and collected the body, struggling to balance their weight as they hauled the deceased onto the boat. It rocked uneasily, threatening to tip, but once they found their center of gravity, it didn't take long before they arrived back on shore. Seeing his pale and lifeless exterior should have been enough proof that it was him, but my brain told me otherwise. I came up with every single excuse for what my eyes were seeing. It was just a hallucination, a pure figment of my imagination as a result from pre-graduation excitement. It was someone else and I was mistaken, a stranger who looked similar. It was all a dream, and at any point I would wake up and attend my graduation ceremony with my very alive best friend standing beside me. Even when his pocket watch and identifications were removed from his person to be inspected, I still didn't blink. This was all a huge misunderstanding, a practical joke, an end-of-year showcase of hilarity. It was a stunt, an act, a gag. Colton wasn't dead. Colton wasn't dead. Colton wasn't dead. Colton wasn't dead. Elliot? I heard my sister calling my name, but it was faint and distant, just an annoying hum in the background. A strange silence engulfed me, deafening my ears and causing me to wrap my arms around my head and hunch in defeat. My surroundings dimmed until I couldn't identify where I was. The scenery had become a blur, a hammering nothingness drumming in my ears, numbness flooding through my body. I couldn't even taste the sand that had entered my mouth due to my long, desperate, and voiceless cries of denial as I kicked the ground in frustration. Elliot! Cass repeated when she reached me, pulling me to her. I'm so sorry. He's not dead, I insisted, throwing her arms off me and backing away. He's not. He can't be. He has no pulse, she whispered carefully, as if afraid the wrong choice of words would shatter what was left of my sanity. Elliot, they think he was murdered. I had only been to 2 funerals in the 18 years of my existence. The first one was for my grandfather, who had passed from cancer. It wasn't a difficult experience, and I mean that in the most sensitive way possible. It was just expected. My family and I had been preparing for months, saying our goodbyes and spending as much time with him as possible. We just knew. What made Colton's funeral a million times harder was the fact that I didn't know he was going to die. Nobody knew. This made the pain strike harder than the first time I had lost someone. The knot in my stomach tightened into a suffocating squeeze, the desperation for closure shredding my insides to ribbons. It kept getting worse, the feeling intensifying, slowly making me feel like I could explode at any moment. Then a shoulder blade bumped into mine, and for a fraction of a second, it gave me a physical sensation, no more pain than a pinch, which allowed me to pull myself from my thoughts and focus on my current surroundings. The guy who had bumped into me smiled sheepishly, apologized, and joined a group of people nearby, engaging in a quiet conversation. It only occurred to me then. Who were these people? Who were the people that were crying into tissues and exchanging a damp Kleenex or two? Who were the people visiting Colton's family and mumbling generic things like deepest sympathies and sincerest apologies? Who were the people engrossed in deep conversations, mentioning the deceased's name as if he were a brother to them? It made my blood boil. It made my fists clench. It made my jaw tighten. It triggered something powerful. Anger. And that's when stage 2 commenced. I can't believe he's gone, Lydia, Colton's girlfriend, mumbled, joining me by one of the pews. Who could have done this to him? I don't know. She brushed a piece of strawberry blonde hair away from her face and dabbed under her eyes. I think I'm going crazy. I keep hearing his voice, hallucinating that he's here. It's like he's trying to communicate to me from beyond the grave.
Doubt it, I answered, keeping my voice monotone.
Maybe I just need counseling, she whispered, staring distantly at nothing in particular.
Maybe. I tried to keep my responses as short as possible. I was still furious.
You're doing that thing, Lydia said, craning her neck to look at me with her big green eyes.
My teeth clenched, a tick pulsing in my jaw.
Your habit of decreasing the words in each response, she explained. I need someone to talk to, Elliot. Please. This is hard for me.
Her words burrowed their way under my skin, latching on and cutting the single thread of control I had left. I turned to her, My anger had transformed into rage, a wild and hungry fire that burned within me. This is hard for me. Had she ever considered that it was hard for me too? Equally, if not more? I was the one who found his body. I was the one who found him dead. I was the one who helped identify that it was really him. Lydia had hardly spoken to me when Colton disappeared, and now she wanted to have a huge heart-to-heart about his passing. Hard for you. It's a tragedy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.